So I can start. Traditionally, at the beginning, I'd like to thank all colleagues who made this conference possible and hope next time we will be able to choose the traditional form. And because this conference is highly interdisciplinary, I try to choose a subject that I think somehow can be useful for people who apply photoactivated compounds, mainly which is based on other benzenes. And I will spend just a couple of minutes to remind the general concept of photopharmacology. We just want to alter the properties. First, let me see, that's okay. First, at all, it's a biological activity and by applying external photostimulus. On the slide, you can see photoactivated molecular switches, which are derivatives of other benzenes, or this is other benzenes. And this is one of the mostly used types of photo switches. And the main principle of functioning is as follows. After absorption of photon, a switch can go to another form, from cis to trans or from trans to cis. To switch the system back, you either can use another photon at different wavelengths, or this process can go back thermally if energy barrier is small enough. And for some applications, it's better if activated form is stable for relatively long time, waiting for another photon to be switched back. It's not always the case. In opposite, for some application, you want fast thermalism, back thermalization. And our understanding of this process, as I found when I started to work on this subject, is far away from full understanding. In this presentation, I will show you some examples of interesting properties of widely used switches. Because we generally set the goals to obtain the methodology that allows us to make design of a compound with desired properties, first, I want to point out some of these properties. First of all, activation spectrum. For practical purpose, the activation spectrum should be shifted usually toward the infrared range. For photo switches that revert from active form to inactive form via photostimulus, it's better if we have significantly different absorption maxima for cis transform. And as I said already, rate of thermalization from active form to inactive form, it's can be extremely important. Stability of photo switch and, for example, solubility in aqueous solution, and sometimes it's a problem as well. And we investigated well-known potassium ion channel blockers proposed by Kramer and Trauner. Here. In this slide, you can see two of these, AAQ from the first generation and DANAQ for the second generation. First of all, the absorption maxima. Just a moment. With DANAQ is shifted toward the red. These factors can be explained quantitatively by different electronic effect substituents, and for first glance, it's not a problem. More detailed understanding is possible if you use quantum chemical correlations. With solubility of these compounds, everything is not so obvious. Everybody who has experienced this compound can say that it's really annoying to try to dissolve AAQ in water. DANAQ, DANAQ on our side, can dissolve easily. And because both compound at the first look has one positive charge and polarity of DANAQ even higher, slightly higher, it looks a bit confusing. Why so big difference in solubility? Trauner's groups measure the time it requires to restore the blocking effect in neurons after photostimulus for both compounds. I just remind the working mechanism for these compounds. In wave transform, they're linear, and both of them can block the potassium channels. After photostimulus, they go to cis form and unblock the channel. It requires time to isomerize back to transform and gain blockway channel. As reported by Trauner's group, AAQ, the blocking effect is restored in approximately 1 hour. Half-life times approximately 8 minutes. And for DNAQ, between seconds, half-life is 305 milliseconds. Authors mentioned that we could not measure the lifetime of this trans isomerization in water because the process is too fast. And actually, the question, what determines biological effects is still open. To answer this, we did a time-resolved measurement of a lifetime of these two compounds in the water. We used time-resolved spectroscopy for nanosecond time resolution to measure thermal isomerization time for these compounds in water and a range of solvents. And we detected this form and found mono-exponential decay, both for AQ and DNAQ. On the left of the slide, you can see evolution of a Bose spectral band of a transform. It's big bands on the left, and for this band, small bands on the right. The band behaves synchronous, one raising and another decreasing with the same exponential behavior. And this is graphic on the right of the slide. We found that at lifetime, 75 microseconds for DNAQ, 8 milliseconds for AAQ. So what we can see? Yes, there is a correlation between thermal isomerization rate and the observed time of blocking effect restoration in neurons. However, thermal isomerization is much faster, and it's definitely not the limiting stage of the deactivation process. So mechanism is still open. The question about mechanism is still open, but at least we know that isomerization in water solution is much, much faster. Okay, so I go to the next slide. We ask a question, why the rate of thermal isomerization and the solubility in aqueous solution are so different between the two generations of its other benzene switches? And our goal was to find a mechanism that defines the key difference in properties between these two compounds. In this case, we can propose design for the desired compounds. Our hypothesis, unusual, but actually for these compounds, pretty unexpected. That's why we have to do a lot of work to prove it. And that AAQ and DNAQ have different protonation state of physiological pH. Of course, the difference protonation state should have a great impact of ability to bind to ion channel, to penetrate the membrane. Again, if you want to do docking, two charges or one charge, absolutely different question. So it's extremely important to understand from the beginning the protonation state of your compound you're working for. And we did a lot of experimental studies and apply various methodology of high-level quantum chemistry to prove this. Here you can see a spectra. We did a measurement at different pH, always properties at different pH. As you can see for AAQ, the spectra almost not sensitive to pH. For DNAQ from our side, you can see huge difference. Again, to understand what's going on, we did a high-level quantum chemistry calculation and we interpret all the bands. Even if it's double bands, and we can resolve these double bands, we can interpret it. So the interpretation is possible only if our hypothesis is right, and we have to protonate DNAQ, and we do not protonate AAQ. So next step, we did kinetic thermal isomerization at different pH. Again, as you can see for AAQ, no difference. For DNAQ, from the beginning it's much faster, and when we have pH2, you have even faster thermal isomerization. Of course, if nitrogen is protonated, this double bond became more like one and a half bond, and isomerization is much easier. So again, it's very consistent. After that, we did Raman measurement. Because interpretation of Raman spectra is not straightforward. Usually you have to do a lot of work. I'm not gonna pay special attention to this, but what I can say, again, we can see, and with results supported by calculation, we really can see what protonation state are different. It's again, it supported our hypothesis. One problem we encountered, but under high pH solubility, DNAQ became much, solubility of DNAQ became much lower and became comparable to solubility AQ. So again, it supports a hypothesis of DNAQ deprotonated the physiological pH and became deprotonated with the same solubility like AAQ at much higher pH. And from our side, it's make it difficult to find the pKa with Raman spectroscopy, because in this case, we have a huge problem with solubility. That's why we use electrochemistry. And again, independently, absolutely a different methodology. And we again prove this hypothesis, and we show that pKa is 11.4. So now I think we have enough proof that DNAQ protonated at physiological pH. And another interesting question we have started to investigate at much lower pH, around 2. We definitely can see deprotonation from another nitrogen. Of course, it's not physiological at all, but probably we can use this effect to design a compound that will behave like a double protonated compound at a physiological pH. The most interesting in this case, we can see a much redshifted absorption maximum. Next, with spectral shift between cis and trans form of DNAQ, we can measure it and we can calculate it. And you can see again, it really depends on the protonation state of a compound. The more protonated compound, usually the shift is bigger. For some applications, can be very useful. Probably it's the main idea I wanted to present. If we work with compounds, we have to understand, first of all, it's not obvious from the beginning. If nitrogen, a double bond, is protonated or deprotonated, it gives absolutely different physiological properties, absolutely different physical properties, and this can be extremely important. And of course, it's not the only way to tune the properties. Here, just very fast, I demonstrate our measurement, our approach to design different compounds using different frameworks, going from other benzols to different compounds. And again, as you can see, it's extremely sensitive to pH. So again, you have a huge variation. And one interesting thing, probably somebody can be interested in that. Pretty obvious idea, if you use not other phenols, but other naphthols. So not as benzenes, but as naphthenes. In this case, of course, we can move absorption maxima to red. And for some applications, it can be extremely important. For some reason, these compounds are still not common. And I think we have a lot of interesting application coming from this compound. So I think I should stop. If somebody have questions, I can answer it.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mikhail. And I think, do we have any questions? Yeah, I see. The question from Piotr Brzezowski. One second.
Can I ask?
Yes, okay, please.
Well, thank you very much. This is very interesting. My question is, what will happen with the solubility of the compound if you will add some charged molecules? It should actually, I suspect, it should increase the solubility because you see, when you talk about...
Yes. It's a well-known effect. In Russian, it's высаливание. I don't know English term. Yes, we did it. Yes, we did. Это высаливание, мы посмотрели, действительно это работает. Yes.
Так, дело в том, что вот это вот со сдвинутым, конечно, спектром в сторону, ну, в синюю сторону, это очень важно, это очень хорошо, так сказать. А вы просто могли бы назвать цифры растворимости, которые, сказать, вот которые...
Redshifted. Растворимость is very good, but it's not at physiological pH, unfortunately. That's the problem.
But you sure
it's very interesting effect. Nobody reported before, but it's at pH 3, pH 4 for this compound. Oh. We're working to move it. Probably we will succeed in that.
Okay, good.
It's very interesting stuff. But for real application, unfortunately, now it's...
Yeah, that's okay.
But naphthenes, okay. If we're talking about naphthenes, as a naphthols, this one, the last one, no, it's now on...
With one additional ring, right?
Yeah, this one it's a physiological pH, naphthenes.
Ah, that's great.
5.32. Yes, this one is physiological pH.
Ah, this is pH 6.4 here it's written. Yes, right. Mm-hmm. Yes. We're pretty close. Okay, it's
yeah.
One.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And the other questions from Dr. Mikhail.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Okay. Mikhail, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, I'm talking to the same room. That's echoes. Maybe I will just.
No, I can hear you. Sorry. I think it's okay.
1 minute, please. Давай.
Okay, Mikhail, my question is, we are talking about resolving very good time scale, like micro and nanoseconds, but what about, say, hundreds of milliseconds would be important to provide good sensitivity in restoration of vision, because we have to... don't have to worry about, say, very high time discrimination, but rather of let light response to grow big enough to depolarize the neuron, so to start spiking. What do you think? How possible is it?
Yeah, I think it's possible, but always will get the problem. If it will be protonated, it will be very fast. And for these big compounds, it's, as I understand, usual problem. AAQ, it's much slower, probably can be pretty good, but solubility is bad.
Mm-hmm.
Again, solubility is bad because it's not protonated. DNAQ solubility is much better, but it's much better because it's protonated. So you always have some properties improve, some properties actually decrease in quality. And that's why we need very carefully design the molecule to get the exact range we need.
Yeah,
a lot of variation a lot of variation because you can use different compounds, you can use different frameworks, you can use different substituents, a lot of possibilities.
Yeah, thank you.
But it's much more complicated when we think.
And we have one more questions from Alexander Rotov. So Alexander, you can talk now.
Yeah. Hello, Mikhail. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
My question is about the compounds under your last slide. As far as I remember, Kramers and Trainer's group, they postulated that A, Q, and Dynac were some kind of fine-tuned to match the particular potassium channels. And what about these ones? Are they expected to match some particular types of channels or?
We never tried yet. Of course, as you can see, it's more bulky, but it's a good idea to try it at channels.
Ready, then the next one. Can you expect them to bound from extracellular or intercellular sites of some channels? Or firstly, you should find out these channels and then make some.
Yeah, Kramers usually think that it's from inside our channels. So it means we have to transfer the compound inside our channel.
Okay.
Yeah, so remember Kramers.
Sorry, I have
inside.
Yeah, because we're out of our schedule. So you can ask Mikhail privately or in chat. So, and we are going further. And our next speaker.